You have to match it with the lab facility, and you have to see the funding. If all the variables are fine, then these are the questions you should be working on. I'm not saying 5 years or 10 years old papers, I'm just saying 2 years old papers, because probably the investigator who has written this has these future plans or might be working on. That means the number of people working on this topic are very few, but these are important because that's why they have highlighted it. Also, go to the conferences, and whenever you go to the conferences, go with only one intention: to hear unanswered questions. That's the most important resource you can extract from the conference. Always there's a discussion between speaker and the audience. And they raise certain questions. Did you do this? Did you do that? And the speaker sometimes says, oh yes, this is an interesting point. I think we should allow it. That is the question for your research. Because that indicates it's not only important, it's also relevant. And no one is left on this question. So these are some of the techniques which people use to answer or to identify the right question. Planning your experiment, for those who are answering the experiment level, make a flowchart of your strategies from start to finish. Focus on every step individually, collect all the methods and tips at each level. Know the budget situation and plan in advance. See, what works in the lab is more important than what is published by somebody. If a technique is already being used in the lab, and somebody has perfected this, use it straight away. Don't worry if it takes more time, if it is not so efficient, but this is something which works, and that will give you immediate results. I remember when I was in Germany, at that time, fluorescence in situ hybridization had just been published. It was just the early phase of fusion protocol, which has come out. And, the director of the center had himself standardized the technique. And he told me a nice story, and he said that when he moved from some university, I think it was Cologne University, to Essen University, in Cologne he perfected the standardized technique basically in his lab, and when he moved to Essen, he did exactly the same protocol, but he could not get results. His own protocol, he could not get results. And then he said, I was very nervous and disturbed and confused why this is not working. And finally he found that they changed the supplier who was supplying water, the pure water in the bottle. Because of this change of supplier, they could not get a result. So he went back to the original supplier. At the time Millikube was just beginning to, these are like very early stages. Even the quality of water was so important, he didn't realize that. But he found that that was the mistake. Of course, it took two days for us to complete one experiment with all the preparation. And then there's somebody published that you can do in 3 hours, you can do in 1 hour. We never tried that. Because we knew that even if you had to wait for 2 days, at least the results are assured. Other things we can try slowly whenever we have time. So what I'm trying to say is, whatever has been standardized in the lab, please use that and reuse that into a formula. It's very important for again experimental people to mention methods as a separate file, especially on loose sheets. The reason why I said loose sheets is because eventually you will find that you can put your own tips and techniques on them. Whatever you've seen is passed on to you. You add your own knowledge, and then when you perfect this over a period of time, then you have a hard-bound book, which is completely novel itself. Experiments, whatever you do, you should be on a hardbound book, not on a loose sheet, simply because of a very important point, not only because you basically save all the results and everything, but also because of intellectual property. If you make an invention and you submit this file to a patent office, the first thing they see is it hardbound, or did you prepare on the same day? Okay? One. Second, they see whether somebody has signed the page whenever you reported that result. Did anybody countersign the page? These are legal requirements. Someone who is not part of your experiment, who is doing some other experiment, but in the same lab, maybe another group. These are legal requirements. You have to get it countersigned by somebody, and then only this becomes a valid document where you can claim that you are the first inventor of this method. And whenever you organize an experiment, the purpose of the experiment should be written on one line, result obtained, say that it's a beautiful result. It is a deviation from your main protocol. Of course, you don't have time to chase failures most of the time, but failure is a result. Please mention that. Failure is not something to be ashamed of, it's a result. Please mention that. And that's exactly what Taylor's office looks into. Did you put it nicely in a glossy way, or did you really maintain a lab book the way it should be? Put your key evidence in the form of picture, table, and graph, and the conclusion. So there's a big difference between data, results, knowledge, and so on. Genome sequence is a data, it's not even information. When you extract motifs out of it, it's an information. And when you use this information to solve a problem, it becomes knowledge. So there's a big difference between data, information, and knowledge. To move from data to information, you need to analyze the data, the raw data that you get. And to move from information to knowledge, you need a lot of experience. Are you able to troubleshoot somebody's problem in the lab? Yes. Okay, then you have knowledge. No, then you are at an information level. Everybody has to pass to the level, three levels. So it's very important that we understand that we deal with data most of the time. Our research offers us a possibility to extract information from this data. And when we really do something useful, which can be applied on a broad scale, then we enter a zone of knowledge. And actually, it's very interesting that on a different level of abstraction, knowledge is memory plus realization. You subtract memory and you have realization. That's another route of gaining knowledge. I'll not touch upon that. I've left it for the afternoon. The data analysis is basically gathering, cleaning, transforming, modeling data, extract useful information, suggest conclusions, and help making good decisions. This is what data analysis is usually about. So if you are worried about these aspects of your study, you have to be clear what is the best approach, what is the best tool, what is the strength and weakness, and did you choose a particular approach, and why did you use it? You have to justify that. You know, doing science, it's sometimes like you're fighting a battle in a court. You have to have a legal document. Why did you do it? Publication is nothing but a legal document. So you're saying that, I have evidence in support of this, this was important, this is my unique value, and this is what should be done in the future. You have to justify at every step. By the way, these slides are available on my website, so I'll give you the URL at the end of the lecture so that you can download it at any time. It's very important that we have a clear perspective of optimal solution versus boundary conditions. Why did you use this approach? There is an optimum answer, and also there's a boundary condition beyond which this approach is not valuable any longer. If you developed a sequence analysis algorithm, you cannot use it for, say, analyzing protein structure. So that's your boundary condition. And then you are very clear that this is the value, the key value of my algorithm. Likewise, every data, every result, every information has a certain best case scenarios and certain boundary conditions, which we should be aware of. And only then we can defend our work. And when you document results must be arranged chronologically. As I said, get your registered assigned by the supervisor. This is very important. This is something we always ignore. But if we are doing some work that has an applied value, some commercial value, then please make sure that you follow these rules. Always store your key results in duplicate. Scan important photographs and email them yourself. Okay. I know when I was a student, there was something very interesting. I had a PhD from Banaras University. And there was a certain time when I had to go home from Banaras to Kashmir. And so I left everything in my lab, all the books, everything on my table, some photographs and all those things, stereotypes basically. And when I came back, I saw everything was missing. And I was very disturbed because it was like 6 months of work. And it turned out, you usually suspect that maybe there's somebody who is, you know, harming me. You know, those kind of thoughts you often get as students, which may not be true all the time. Can be your carelessness, as well as my case. And it turned out that the person who was cleaning the lab every day thought that it's a trash and it burned up. He just, you know, destroyed all those papers. And then this guy was so happy. They said, he said, "Look, I kept your lab clean." I said, "Thank you very much." So it's very important. And I had to go back, and all those chromosomes, all the banding has been destroyed. It, you know, if you do gene banding, how the life of these chromosomes is not so much. But anyway, the take-home message here is that once you get results, just grab them, scan that, put the photographic evidence, email that to yourself, so that you have a non-destructible record somewhere. Because you never know when you need this result, maybe you lose it in the process. And also, if you have obtained this result with some variation in methodology, please list it out. Okay? And it's very important that whenever we organize our science, we first consult the IP department, ask them those and those. Don't repent later that this is what I should have done, could have done, but actually consult them and say, in the Indian scenario or in the global scenario, how would you like the results to be presented? And they have a set pattern, you know, it's not so difficult to remember that. Whenever you're working in the lab, it's very important that you're aware of the lab procedures, you're aware how to basically dispose of toxic chemicals, harmful organisms, and if something wrong happens, how to troubleshoot that. Again, I remember my example when I was working in Manipal. I said I was human genetics division, and I had 4 PhD students who worked on cancer and cytogenetics. And while I was teaching them how to do tissue culture and you know all those things, and I was demonstrating it, and I took all the tissue in the needle full of cancer cells, and then I said, okay, that's how we do pour. And the needle slipped from my hand and straight away went into my thighs. But everyone is panicked. But fortunately, nothing happened. But there can be situations when, you know, it can lead to ugly results, and you need to be clear as to how do we, you know, basically troubleshoot those, you know, situations that arise beyond your experience and knowledge. So troubleshooting is very important, and that's one aspect that abroad they put a lot of emphasis. In fact, in Regan, we have such a strong you know, list of do's and don'ts. And scientists are periodically sent for seminars and workshops to update themselves about the latest safety procedures. To the extent that if you have to take out the pipette from this you know, disposable pipette, you basically see that it has got, this packet has got paper side and the plastic side. We normally throw everything in one bin, but over there we actually separate it out. Even that paper that is coming from the disposable plastic is put separately and the plastic is put separately. This is eco-friendly and this is the right thing to do. So abroad, I would say, there are a lot of emphasis given on the safety procedures. Also in India, I've been to many excellent universities and centers. So this is very, very important to be aware of the safety procedures. Now, when you finally get the results and you're happy with the conclusion and so on, then you want to communicate science. So how do we do that? We basically communicate by publishing scientific papers, and we look at impact factor of the journal. Now, what is an impact factor, basically? Impact factor tells you how many people read this journal, how many people think that this journal is important. But it does not mean that a journal with very high impact factor has the most important papers. Please make a distinction clear in your mind. Even Nature journal, if you look at the Nature journal, with the highest impact factor, one of the, you know, the premier journals. All the papers are not cited to that extent. It is a long table. Some are very highly cited and some are not cited at all. Okay? So just publishing in Nature as a Science Journal doesn't really mean anything. In fact, that's one thing our president, Dr. Mayori, is strongly against. Because we have a culture of, historically, people have published a lot of papers in Science and Nature, almost every 6 months, some other thing, you know, keeps coming. And then this actually goes against other scientists who publish important work in other good journals, relevant journals. So he set up an example, and he never published a major in Science so far. And he says, I want to prove to you, do good work and publish in relevant journals. And see how many people are talking about your work. It doesn't matter that you're publishing major in Science. And I can tell you, major in Science publications, many times it comes to the network, if you have the right contacts. I mean, I'm not going to the details of that, but what I'm trying to say is that what's more important is what kind of work you have done, what is your scientific output, and also are you publishing in the right journal rather than a trendy journal. Also there are issues about open access versus traditional model. So open access initiative basically allows you to own your own results, whatever conclusions, whatever knowledge you retrieve from your experiment, you are the owners. You have to pay a small fee for that because open access journals are basically, they're not funded by commercial ventures. They are typically funded by scientific people. So open access journals offer you this advantage that you know, you can actually own this. So tomorrow if you have certain results and you want to republish this in another journal or you want to present in a conference, if you have a publication in open access journal, it's easy for you. If you do not have it, you have a publication in a traditional journal, then you need to ask the permission of the editor of the journal or the publishing agency actually. Because you transfer your rights to the publishing agency and then you need to ask them permission, can I use this figure or can I use this?
I just wanted to know, is there a stigma about open access journals?
No, there is nothing.
We find here that, you know, because you are paying money, and
yes,
people think that, you know, oh, open access journal, you are getting some money and getting. But I find that for computational biology and all, there is a very good review process.
Absolutely.
But in India, generally, there is a stigma about this.
Well, we also have gone through that in writing. Historically, people have only focused on Nature and Science. And we got a lot of that. And now people are fed up because it just doesn't really generate a value, the impact. For example, I tell you, systems biology or synthetic biology, because I've easily been started in Japan, if the impact factor is so high all the time. But this was started by a group of people in the United States. Right? So if we have the right kind of attitude and innovativeness, we can always do that. But because we are always focusing on publishing somehow in the top journals and, you know, getting some benefit out of that, thankfully, in Vulcan, this philosophy has recently changed, ever since President Mayori joined the RICAN, and he said, I don't have even one paper in Nature in Science. So why don't you look at me and, you know, learn something. Recently, yes, I would say 2-3 years ago, the core philosophy has changed a lot. And they said, like, whatever you do, wherever you publish, if people are citing your work, one, or independent press is covering your work, or you get invited to important scientific meetings, that is an evidence that your work is relevant. And that's exactly what they look for. They don't look for all those high impact factors any longer. That's their response. Okay, so again, you know, presenting your work in important scientific meetings, meeting the press, one has to be prepared for all this. As we evolve as scientists, you know, from students, we get across these roles. Eventually, you know, you have to be multitasking, but systematically, if you prepare yourself, it will be wonderful. I'd also like to mention here that, you know, when we write scientific papers, and I've seen a lot of them from students' media, also abroad, we generally use the language of the press. So newspaper English. Communicating science has never done that. In fact, the reviewers get so annoying. Even if it's good work, they just throw it away. They say, I don't have time to correct the grammar all the time. This is not my job. Even if it's a good work. So first of all, please teach yourself. Please learn how to communicate science in the form of publication. The language has to be different. It is no longer a newspaper English. For example, when you write a C program, you have to be very careful about full stop, about comma, about the parenthesis. You have to be very careful, because otherwise computer will not allow you to move further. And if you are careful there, why can't we be careful when you are publishing science? When you are publishing your scientific output in the journal, you have to have the same level of rigor and the same level of discipline that you have when you write a program. So there are some very good books available